We're Elmgreen and Dragset, in order of appearance. You can start.
Yeah. In 94, we met in a nightclub called After Dark. And we didn't go to that nightclub because we were seeking a collaborating partner, actually. At that time, none of us were doing art, and we didn't have any art educational background. I was writing poetry. It was back in Denmark, so that was for a very, very tiny little group of people. You know how many people buy poetry, and in a language zone like Danish, it's approximately 200, so you can just Xerox your copies instead of get them publicized. And Inga was doing theater.
Yeah, it was more physical theater, street theater, performance theater. Also maybe sometimes the kind of street theater you see and you throw the rest of your donut after the performer. We started out combining our backgrounds in a way, doing art performances in galleries and wherever we could find a free space to do something. In the very beginning, we were a couple, and we did performances that maybe were based on having met, being in love. It was more centered around bodies, new identities, maybe new queer identities as well. But we, through these experiments and maybe durational, ritualistic live acts, we came to sort of discover the maybe limits and conventions of art spaces and the art scene. And we were rather surprised about how strict the art world could be in many ways.
Yeah, because we didn't come from like an art academic background, we were not used to the white cube, for instance. And we had a residency in New York shortly after we started. We started 1 year after meeting each other, doing performances together. And we came into these white cube spaces, commercial galleries in Soho and Chelsea, and were passing by like counters that were this high and seeing like the gallery girls and boys tapping on their computer and looking up at you with very tired eyes and spotting that you would be in student clothes, so you were not someone who could pay for the artworks, and then they would look down again. And we were like, wow, is that how the artworks celebrate exhibitions? And we were really shocked about it. And we thought, well, there must be something very evil about all that white paint and these white cubes. So we wanted to test out what would happen if you would add actually like 300 gallons of this white paint in a white cube space and then wash it down again and see if maybe the space would be generated to be a bit more dynamic and lively.
Yeah. This was called 12 hours of white paint, and that's what we did for the 12 hours. We should have done a double Warhol sleep later, because we slept for 24 hours after that from the fumes of the paint, I think. It was before ecological paint was invented. That's how old we are. This work is called Powerless Structures, Figure 11. Maybe some of you might have seen a version of that last summer at the Ponta della Dogana in Venice. This is the 1997 version of it, and it's permanently installed at the Louisiana Museum, north of Copenhagen. Also here, we continued in a way the exploration of the, what can you say, the membrane of the gallery space. Here the board, or the diving board, is penetrating this panoramic window where you see the sea between Denmark and Sweden.
We started doing sculptures, and this is one of our first sculptures, because we suddenly got curated as being this gay couple doing something festive in the corner if someone made a really boring exhibition, and we got a bit tired of having that kind of very stereotypical position, so we said, okay, let's also make something that is standing still and is a bit more silent.
You could mention that this is a sculpture in a whole series of works we did called Powerless Structures. We were inspired by Foucault's theories on power structures and how they don't actually impose any power in themselves. It's a lot to do with our perception of these structures, and a structure can always be morphing or interchanged or fully exchanged. Well, that was more or less the same, wasn't it? But anyway, we don't have much time, so we only show this one example. But you know, all these sculptures basically dealt with space in one way or another, and we decided to use his philosophy in a way to study like everyday objects around us.
Then being like an artist too, and dealing with your everyday working method and making objects and performances, we suddenly felt it would also be fun to make a third persona, invent a third persona, a character that suddenly would have a single individual's voice. And we started to invent some fictional characters that would inhabit art spaces. And when we were asked to do the Nordic and the Danish pavilions in Venice in 2009, we invented two types of collectors. We did that because we thought it was a bit tiring to hear in news media about collecting would all be about investment and auction hype and so on, because collecting, the act of collecting had been so much more complex and interesting throughout history. People have been collecting all kind of weird stuff as an obsession or as a support to the arts. So we invented these fictional characters that suddenly kind of extended our collaboration somehow. We got a third persona in our exhibition praxis.
Which also gave us an opportunity in a way to deal with each other's bad sides in a way. We could, you know, sort of give them to another character, and it became strangely therapeutic. Maybe you could also mention that we didn't hold out as Diller and Scofidio did. We were a couple for 10 years, but we totally recognize what they say when they say that 1 year, you know, living together and working together is probably like 5 years in another person's life. After we split up as a couple, our work in general became more narrative. I mean, maybe we had a different need to talk and to put different layers onto the work.
It's also, when we speak about collaboration, it's kind of fun because you collaborate in many ways with a lot of other people, like the multiple you are, like, as an artist, a lot of different persons according to your mood swings. You have maybe a gallery staff who you also collaborate with, and you collaborate with the curators every time you do an exhibition. So I think actually every artist is somehow a collaborating artist. It's not only like duos or artist collectives that are like collaborating artists.
And of course, in this particular project in Venice, we invited 23 other artists to help us tell the stories of these people that have lived in the two different pavilions, whereof one of them was the mysterious Mr. B, who is lying here face down in the pool. He took his Prada shoes off before he went in.
As artist dudes, you are maybe a little bit of an alien still in the art world. Like, there are not too many of us, and like in big exhibitions, you are normally like maybe two or three, maximum three artist collectives represented in a biennial.
We're more expensive. I mean, it's double the flight tickets and per diems. I mean, budgets explode.
And the trouble and the discussions. So, like this feeling of being displaced, we have expressed in a certain number of works where we like to place things that don't really belong to the environment. And one of the first things we did was placing a forever closed Prada store outside Marfa on Highway 90 in the middle of the desert to test out how this luxury goods boutique would appear if it was completely isolated from its supporting urban structure.
Whereas the Prada store and this very urban sort of structure doesn't fit very well in the Wild West nature. This sort of kidney-shaped garden pool doesn't fit very well into the urban structure of New York. This is the project that's up currently at Rockefeller Plaza. It is, as you can see, from that side, I wonder if you only have images from that side, a pool, and if you see it on the back side, it's maybe more reminiscent of a high modernist Hans Arp sculpture in its shape.
And we titled the pool Van Goghsia as a comment on the artist myth, like the idea that still sits in the art world about the lonely genius artist working as a individual. And I think still there's certain parts of the art world that has big difficulties coping with two people working together, making their project based on a dialogue instead of getting the ideas up from the big god and developing their art out of a lonely inspiration. So the title here is hinting on that situation of Van Gogh as the ultimate lonely, isolated artist, and us as an artist too.
I see we're 47 seconds over time, but we'd still like to end with two very inspiring and collaborating philosophers. It's Deleuze and Guattari, having been asked on why they didn't invent a fake name for themselves. On keeping their own names, they said, to reach the point where it is no longer of any importance whether one says I. We are no longer ourselves. Each will know his own. We have been aided, inspired, multiplied. Strangely ambiguous as usual, but we're all many. Thank you.